Judges 15, 14 through 15. And when he, Samson, came unto Lehi, he was where? Lehi. The Philistines shouted in triumph against him. And the Spirit of the Lord came mightily upon him. And Lehi, why you keep saying Lehi? Because it's very relevant to where we're going today. And the cords that were upon his arms became as flax that was burnt with fire, and his bands loosed from off his hands. And this is the reason why the Holy Spirit loosed his bands. He knew his now what, because verse 15 says, and he found. Found means he sought. He found the Lord faithful, so he sought, and he found a new jawbone of an ass. New. Not been laying there for 1,000 years. It was messy, gory, and everything. Don't miss your miracle because it's messy. And he put forth his hand. The Lord did not grab it for him, but he provided the weapon for him. But he had to put his hand to the weapon. And he took it. And he took it. Look at your neighbor and say, you got to take it. And slew 1,000 men therewith. And that's going to be relevant to some of the teachings that we're going to have too. So, Father, thank you for the reading of your word. We give you glory, honor, and praise this morning. In Jesus' name. And everybody said amen. You may be seated. Hallelujah. Throw Judges 15:16 on the screen. Just for a second. It's relevant to what I'm going to teach you here. I was going to go with Judges 15:17 through 19. Let's throw 16 in there. And that's something new to him, so. And he's got it already. All right. And Samson said, with the jawbone of an ass, heaps upon heaps, with the jawbone of an ass have I slain 1,000 men. Heaps upon heaps. That's, in other words, he piled men on top of each other, like if you're going out and cutting brush, you'd throw brush, you know, that big brush pile. Heaps upon heaps. That's people. So it's a heightened place, okay? So let's get into some teaching. Let's keep this rolling, verse 17. So just give me about 10 minutes to teach you on something, then I'll let loose and do some ninja kicks or something. And it came to pass, when he had made an end of speaking, that he cast away the jawbone out of his hand, and called that place Ramoth Lehi. The word Ramah there, I found two meanings and credible sources. It's one of those that I just didn't find one that was obscure, and then the majority was one way. There's a lot of, you know, it has to do with little jots and tittles and everything about the word. But the consensus of the word Rama either means height, or it means to toss. And you can see both of those right here. Because Ramoth Lehi, I'm getting this in a second, that word Lehi literally means jawbone. That's the Jewish word, or the Hebrew word, for jaw or jawbone, Lehi. So he named this place Jawbone. But it was, I guess, named even before then. So that's obviously by the way this place looked. Okay? And also Ramah Lehi. So you can either have two thoughts on the word on height. That it would either mean, just because you see other places that say, hey, Ramah, and then the name of a place, it means a heightened place. And if you go through like the book of Judges, some of them were not good places. They were called the high places, where they worshipped false gods, Ashtaroths and that stuff. You know, you hear it in the Old Testament, the high places. Well, that's what Ramoth would mean is high places. So Lehi itself is probably a high place in the hills. It's a little higher place, okay? But it also would have that meaning there, heaps upon heaps. I imagine Samson probably might even have stood on top of that. So he called that place Ramah Lehi, the height of the jawbone. Or it makes sense because of the way Scripture reads itself. He said he cast away the jawbone out of his hand and called that place Ramoth Lehi. So the other definition of the word, which is to toss, would totally make sense. And I lean towards that because Scripture itself says that he took and he cast away the jawbone out of his hand. And when he cast it away, or Ramoth tossed, then he named the place Tossing of the Jawbone. Y'all with me on that so far? All right, I had a lot of questions about this last week. That's why I'm trying to break some of this down. Verse 18, and he was sore athirst and called on the Lord and said, thou hast given this great deliverance unto the hand of thy servant. And now shall I die for thirst and fall into the hand of the uncircumcised? How many of us have went through battles and this is like, yeah, the Lord, yeah, we took him down. The Lord opened up a can on him. Yeah. Woohoo, go God. And about 3 months later, oh, Jesus. Just like they did in the wilderness, right? Every time the Lord would show up in power, it wouldn't be long. They were complaining about it, something new. Amen. Well, guess what? Samson's just like us in some ways. So here he is. Shall I die of thirst and fall into the hands of the uncircumcised? But God, Baca, clave, Baca, that means to split open. An hollow place, Maktesh, which means a depression or a cavity. So God, Baca, Maktesh, he split open a depression or a cavity that was in the jaw. What's the name of jawbone again? Lehi. And some different translations, and not the King James, it actually says Lehi there. Well, why would it say Lehi instead of jaw? Because that's the actual literal translation of it. So he says that, so the hollow place that was in Lehi. So God split open a depressed or a cavity-like place that was in Lehi. And there where he split it open, came water thereout. And when he had drunk, his spirit came again. His spirit came again. Did the Lord not be faithful? Amen. Yes, he's faithful. And he revived. Oh, if we would just call forth and drink from the living water, we would be revived. Wherefore he called the name thereof. See, now where he tossed the jawbone, it was already in Lehi, and Ramah, the tossing of the jawbone, which is literally what it means, he took, and it says he cast away the jawbone. So there's a whole big area called Ramoth Lehi. It's a big area. Now he's getting ready to name a small area within Ramoth Lehi. Are you with me? Okay, it's like Mobile County, but then there's Theodore. Okay, so it's kind of like that. So wherefore he called the name thereof, where the water sprung up, he called that place and Hakkari, which is in where? Lehi. It's within Lehi to this day. Okay, let me break this down. Holy Spirit notes that God clave, or he opened up, he split open the hollow place in Lehi, causing the water to gush forth so Samson's spirit could be revived. Now that word, Maktesh, or hollow place, only other occurrences is in Proverbs 27:22. It's the only other place in Scripture, Proverbs 27:22, where it denotes mortar. It uses the word mortar. And the word mortar is a bowl-shaped cavity in which substances are reduced to powder with a pestle. Have you ever seen movies like that? A little bowl place and somebody's got like a little, like a some kind of a stone or big piece of wood, and they're just grinding stuff within that. You got a word picture now? So this place looked like that. That's why it's named that. That's why he named the place in Hackory. Okay? And that's why it says that it come out of a hollow place. In other words, it come out of a place that looked like a mortar, a bowl. It literally, I'm going to say this again here in a second, it literally looked like, the rock looked like a molar in the back of a jaw. A depressed area. If you look at a tooth, a molar, it has a cavity. It has a depressed place in it. So we're looking at a big rock that looked like a giant molar. All right, you with me on this? That you understand that, and this passage will make a little more sense to you. So upon close study, it would appear that the water didn't come out of a literal jawbone, but that it sprang up in the location of Lehi, which is the same word for jawbone, where the battle took place. So Samson named Lehi, Ramoth-Lehi, the casting away or the tossing of a jawbone. And the name that Samson gave to the area within Ramoth-Lehi, where water was brought forth, is in Hackory. And that word means fountain of one calling, or it means spring of the caller. There was somebody calling forth to the Lord, and the water sprung out. That's what that word actually means in Hebrew, okay? It means fountain of one calling, or spring of him who prayed. That implies that this was the name of a spring, not a jawbone. Hollow place, we talked about that, maktesh, is a masculine noun referring to a depression, a hollow in a jawbone or mortar bowl. It is used of a hollow place in a jawbone where the molar tooth was. In the case of our scripture here in Judges 15:19, it is used figuratively to refer to a seam in a rock that resembles the molar cavity of a jawbone, which, when struck, opens up, releasing water trapped between layers of limestone. Amen. You guys got that? You got some good teaching there? Some college-type material there? Hallelujah. Okay, now let's get into some fun stuff. Here we go. So a jawbone will protect. A jawbone will preserve and propel you in one season, but not in another. And we took time on that a few weeks ago. Remember that? My jawbone. You don't need a jawbone right now. You need a cup of water. Jawbone ain't going to do you no good, but a cup of water will revive you and give you life. So toss it and go looking again for what the Lord has provided for you now. We live by faith. We embrace our now what. And your now what may be a cup of water representing, listen, the need of refreshment, rest, and restoration from the previous season. I want to say that again before I get all happy and put some scripture on the, because I'm going to preach myself happy during this. I know where I'm going. It's good. Your now what may be a cup of water representing the need of refreshment, rest, and restoration from the previous season. Throw 1 Kings 19, 5 through 8. I'm going to read it, and then I'm going to give myself permission to let loose. 1 Kings 19, 5 through 8. And as he, being Elijah, lay and slept under a juniper tree, behold, then an angel touched him and said unto him, arise and eat. And he looked, and behold, there was a cake baking on the coals and a cruse of water at his head. And he did eat and drink. You know, you can lead a horse to the water, but can't make it drink. The Lord can prepare a table before you, but he can't make you come and eat. Well, Elijah's being obedient here. And he did eat and drink, and laid him down again. And the angel of the Lord came again, the second time, Look at your neighbor and say, the second time. And touched him and said, arise and eat, because the journey is too great for thee. Look at your neighbor and say, without Jesus, you ain't making it. He's telling him, I'm waking you up again, because this journey that you have on is too great for you. 8, and he arose and did eat and drink. Gosh, I want to start preaching right now. And went in the strength of that meal. Look at your neighbor and say, that meal. Specific, that meal. 40 days and 40 nights unto Horeb, the Mount of God. The first meal. Bombs here. You need to write this down. The first meal was to restore Elijah from where he had been. That's past tense. We've all been somewhere. And the first meal was to restore. Look at your neighbor and say, restore. To restore Elijah from where he had been. You're not to live in the past, but you may need a season to recover from the past. It's like there's so many people that, like, they get out of one relationship and they just start to get into another relationship. What do they call that? Rebound. Thank you. Rebounding. Everybody rebounding. Don't know if their 3-point shooters are good or their assists are good, but man, I tell you, look at the stats. They got a lot of rebounds. Amen for sports fans out there. Rebounding. You, if your journey has been long and it's been a tough season, you don't need to just jump into something or with someone. You need a season of rest. You don't live in the past, but sometimes you need to take time to recover from the past. You got scars to prove it. But this day and age, so many people just rush out and just, well, I'll just try it again. I'll just go here and do this and that instead of just, let me just sit down a minute now. Lord, what went right? What went wrong? What was my part in it? What wasn't my part in it? Help me to learn from this so I can be stronger as we go again. But right now, I just need to catch my breath. So we don't live in the past. But we may need a season to recover from the past. Now the second meal was to sustain Elijah for where he's going. Future tense. One meal, where I've been. The next meal is from where I'm going. And that's what I want to concentrate on for the rest of this message. Where are you going? Now what? Because if Elijah had eaten the first meal and said, I'm good. Thanks, Lord. I've got it from here. Listen. He would have fainted because the angel said, you and yourself don't have the strength for what's getting ready to happen. You need to eat again. His second meal was for where he was going. Oh, there was a little something, something in that meal. Hallelujah. Sustained him for 40 days and 40 nights. And we wonder why we're so tired and fatigued. And the Lord's saying, come here, sit and rest a minute. I want to feed you for where you're going. I ain't got time, Lord. I ain't got time. Places to go, people to see, things to do. You're going to faint. Because he's trying to give you some sustenance. And I want to get to the end of where I'm going already today. And it's about Oh, I just got to hold back my mule. Because I'm going to switch this thing on you in a minute. We're going physical, but we're going spiritual too. I want to feed you from where you're going. I don't want to go to church. I don't want to listen. I don't know. That's not important. It's not irrelevant. It don't matter. Sun's going to rise tomorrow. It's going to set tomorrow. Big deal. Come and rest and let me feed you with something special that's going to get you through where you're going. Why is it that everybody in the body of Christ that confesses a Christian are just so tired? I'm tired. And if you really listen to them, they're frustrated. They don't have answers to questions. They battle with anxiety. They battle with depression. And it just so happens they don't show up on a regular basis to eat the meal that's provided for them that's going to sustain them. You can't even get them. Let me back up here. Thank you, Holy Spirit. You can't even come in to get them to get restored from where they'd been. They're already wanting to go somewhere, and they can't even get restoration from where they've been. Hey, even if you take the restoration from where you've been, you still got to sit for a minute and get some nutrients from where you're going. This is a two-part deal here. This is A and B, and you don't even want, most of them don't even want to do A. They don't want to confront. And they just want to jump right to B and then blame God because things don't work yet. Woo! Hallelujah! He would have fainted in the day of adversity if he hadn't have got that second meal, for his strength would have been small. Put Proverbs 24:10 on the screen. Proverbs 24:10. This is a new one. I didn't give it to him last night. They'll get it in a second. Because it is not, saith the buyer, but when, no, that is not. Proverbs 24:10. 24:10. You got the numbers kind of right. Amen. If thou faint in the day of adversity, here's what the Word of God says. Here's the deal is, your strength is small. You see so many Christians just fainting like the world. Why? Because their strength's small. Well, tell me something. How do you get strengthened? What are they even going to tell you from the hospital when you're sitting there and all you got is an IV in your arm? What are they trying to do? They won't try to get you to eat. Why? Because they know that if you can get an appetite and you can start eating, you'll gain your strength back. And we got so many Christians on IVs. And they won't eat. And their strength is small. So guess what happens in the day of adversity? I don't even want to know your opinion. This is God's opinion. It's the only opinion that counts. And it's the only one that's absolutely 100% correct. So you can have your opinions all you want to. But when you faint in the day of adversity, it's because your strength is small. And your strength is small is because you have not come to the table to eat. Man does not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. The angel said, this journey, his next, the new assignment, his now what, was too great for him. So, Elijah needed a second meal. He needed to prepare for next. And the Lord furnished all that was needed. Take an inventory. What has he brought into your life? What still remains in your life? That's all you need. As we said this morning, I'm not impressed at big conferences or rallies when people are just, good music, good singing, and we're all together and we're just doing a thing. What impresses me is, can you get alone before God? you and God at home, in the car, in the shower, somewhere, and can pour out your heart without anybody else around. Can you do that? Oh, I remember doing that before we moved. I can remember that the song, My Redeemer is coming, my my deliverer is passing by, something like that. And because here I am, and I'm, you know, working the 40 plus hours at the saw blade manufacturing plant, but I knew there was more for my life. I don't have a college education. I don't know nobody. I'm not a blue blood, but I knew there was more. And I remember on going to work in the morning and the sun rising, get out of my car and just throw my hands up to the Lord while that song was playing, and I could get and give a rip who was going by or what they thought, because I knew my deliverer was coming. I didn't know exactly how or why, and that's not supposed me for to know. What my part is to believe it. And how do you know you'll believe it? Those in faith school, you're going to act on it. It was just more than just a warm, fuzzy feeling. I pulled over on the side of the road. Hallelujah. Got out of my car. Turned my music up. Didn't give a rip who was going by. And threw my hands up unto my God. Because I knew my deliverer was coming. I knew he'd be passing by. I knew there was much more for me than this. I knew that he had it worked out. I knew he had a plan. He had a place. He had a purpose. If I would just follow the process and the principles that he laid out in front of me, it's going to be all right. Amen. And you believed it because you acted on it. I told you I was going to preach myself happy. So you're now what may be an assignment to rest and to recover from where you have been. Or you're now what may be an assignment to prepare and get ready for your next. Elijah bought into the process. He waited on the Lord and renewed his strength. That's Isaiah 40:31. You don't have to put it on the board or the screen. Isaiah 40:31. This was a stay here moment. Remember going over that message a few weeks ago? Go there, stay here. This was a stay here moment and not a go there moment. He recognized his new. Getting ahead of the Lord is a good way to self-sabotage your next. You can be behind a little bit and still see if the Lord's zigging or zagging. But you won't have a clue where you're going if you're the one up front leading the way. You got to know your now what. Well, am I in a transition or a new season? Let me teach you on this a second. Transitions have a short shelf life, but are very intense. They're active and can change like the weather. A lot of people are saying, well, I'm just in a tough season. You're not in a season. You're in a transition. A season can last a long time, and it can progress very slowly. Don't confuse a transition with a season. Elijah was in a transition from one assignment to another. So because of the intensity, he needed restoration and preparation. Look at your neighbor and say, you need both. The need for sustenance and nourishment doesn't change. But the why you need nourishment and sustenances, the application for which provision is needed, now that does change. You need to know your now what. Well, what are you trying to say, Pastor? I'm glad you asked. You're supposed to eat to live, not live to eat. I knew it'd be quiet on that one. You need to eat differently and for different reasons in different seasons, depending on the journey and the destination. If you're taking notes, you want to write this right here down. You eat for where you're going, not for where you are. You eat for where you're going, not for where you are. What are your goals? What are you trying to accomplish? What is needed for your specific assignment? Bless their heart, so many people in the body of Christ don't even know what it is. No wonder they're eating junk food. How you eat shows those who know nutrition what you're trying to achieve. Oh, it's going to get even better. You would eat more of a high-carb breakfast than a low-carb breakfast if you were riding your bicycle to work as opposed to driving to work in your vehicle. Because the destination and the means to which you get there would require more energy for a bicycle than a car. So you eat the foods that will give you more energy. Somebody gonna get a hold of this and know where I'm going. Hallelujah. If you're trying to put on muscle mass, you'll need to eat 1.5 to 2 grams of protein per pound of body weight. So in other words, if you weigh 100 pounds, you need to get either 150 grams or 200 grams of protein in a day. If you really want to put on, if you're really serious about it. That's the way you got to eat. You're eating for where you're going, not where you are. Again, you eat for where you're going, not for where you are. A pregnant woman is eating differently during the pregnancy than she did before the pregnancy. Why? Because her reasons for eating has changed and she's eating for two. What part of God's word are you feeding on? Let me go back to the natural for just a second. If you're wanting to lose weight, then maybe you need to cut carbs. You need a good Mediterranean diet. Well, I need to lose 50 pounds. Well, where you are right now is you have that extra 50 pounds, but you're eating for where you're going, your goals, your ambitions. Once again, if you're an athlete that and your sport demands that you have a high rate of cardiovascular in your routine, you can eat a little more carbs. So you see, you eat specific. You can't just eat anything. Somebody who wants to make it to the NFL just can't sit back and eat bonbons, potato chips, go out and eat ice cream all the time.
Body by cookies and corn dogs.
That's not going to cut it for where they want to go. You have to eat on purpose of where you're going, not where you've been. Now, let's make this little pivot here. What part of God's word are you feeding on? Because you should be eating from where you're going, not where you've been. Do you know where you're going? You eat for where you're going, not for where you are. So no wonder so many are not prepared for next because they're feeding on now and not next. They're eating like it's the off season, and it's not the off season. If you've been diagnosed with cancer, you need to feed on healing and faith. What are you feeding on? You can feed about loving your brother and sister all you want to, but cancer could care less. But you start eating on healing and eating on faith, and that stuff's got to go in the name of Jesus. You want to become an entrepreneur. You need to feed on relationships and stewardship. Because you want this thing to grow. Well, you're not going to do anything in life without people. I don't care. Whatever vocation God has called you to, it's either two things. It's either goods or services. And both of them are for people. You better get used to relationships. And if God has given something to you, it's no longer yours. It's His. And you need to learn about stewardship. If you want to become more financially independent, you need to feed on the laws of giving and wisdom. Do you know what the tithe is? Do you really understand why it is, the four types of giving? Tithing, offerings. Do you know the difference between the two? What about alms? You know the difference between alms and offerings? Hallelujah. What about first fruits? And your finances probably don't look yippy-skippy. But if you want to increase financially, why aren't you feeding on the laws of giving and on wisdom? Because you know what? I could follow the laws of giving and know the difference between all the giving and do that just fine, but not have wisdom and just what I have left over, just spend it like there ain't no tomorrow. Ain't no wisdom in it. You need to go through the book of Proverbs and read about wisdom. You feed based on the need, then sow that seed. Thank you for that one amen, because I thought it was better than one amen. One meal was for where Elijah had been, and one was for where he was going. What you're feeding on is preparing you for tomorrow. But not any old diet will produce any old results, because you are what you eat. Hallelujah. You can do heavy resistance training for months, but if your next is running a 26-mile marathon, your training has been in vain. Well, I can bench press a Buick. That's not going to help you about mile 5, Bubba. And you got a long way to go. You wasted time, money, energy, finances, and everything. It's a waste. Because you didn't train, you didn't eat for where you're going. So, if your training doesn't match your tomorrow, then tomorrow will be a hard pill to swallow, because you're not ready for it. And it's not going to wait on you either. It's coming, whether you want it to or not. It's coming. Again, you eat for where you're going, not for where you are. Man, that's good. You can't just shotgun it in the Word of God. What's God called you? Where's your next? What is He putting in your heart? Are you feeding on that? Because if I want to lose weight, but yet I've got a high, simple carb diet, and McDonald's is my best friend, you can pray, bind, and loose all you want to. But your diet is indicative to where you want to go. You have to line up your diet. Oh, who am I preaching to this morning?
Glory be to God. Are you eating on purpose? What are you feeding on in the Word of God? What has He woke you up in the night seasons and put on your heart? Write it down and go study it. Feed in that area, and you'll be strong in that area, and you will not faint in the day of adversity. Why? Because your strength won't be small. You'll be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. Are you tailoring your now through where you've been or where you're going? It may be you need a new weapon specifically designed for a new battle because the old one won't get the job done. Or you could say, I need a new set of training. I need to train different for this one. I need to eat differently for this one. I need to do a lot of things differently for this one. You may need a new wisdom. Oh, this is good. You may need new wisdom, in order to reconcile old relationships for the purpose of future endeavors. Are you hearing me? Why? Because you need them for where you want to go. And so you need that new wisdom to reconcile those old relationships because how you've always handled them has failed. And that failure could cost you your future. Might have to eat some humble pie. You need some wisdom because God has set them to be a part of where you're going. You might need new wisdom to reconcile that relationship. So you will have a future endeavor. You may only need a new perspective of your current conditions to see that the grass isn't always greener on the other side. It's just always greener where you water it. But whatever you need, the Lord has already made provision, whether it's here or whether it's there. But you have to recognize your new. Stand to your feet as the music plays. As the music plays. Here we go. God is. Look at your neighbor. Say, He is. He's not was or will be. He is. God is faithful. So go looking and you'll experience finding. Go knocking and things will open. Keep asking and you'll keep receiving. Whether your now what is here or whether it's there, whether it's old or whether it's new, whether you have it or you need to obtain it. Listen, God's got you. This might not be good English, but do you got God? Now what?